These male sex hormones are structurally more related to these corticosteroids, and they are synthesized from the same starting element, that is the cholesterol, and have the same similar, they share the same synthetic pathway up to some extent. So the next that comes after the corticosteroid is this male sex hormones. So they have the same CPP ring, cyclopentanepar hydroxyanthrene ring, and both the primary compound, that is testosterone, and this more active form that is synthesized after the release of the testosterone from its source, from the testis, it is converted elsewhere into the dihydrotestosterone. Okay, so dihydrotestosterone is more active. It is less active, it is more active. Okay, and even their precursors are have also some degree of androgenic activity, although in the range of 1/20 to 1/30, like dihydroepiandrosterone and androstenedione. They have around 1/20th or 1/30th range of androgenic activity. They are called weak androgens, and these are the actual androgens. This is dihydrotestosterone is more active than the testosterone, almost two to three times more active, or almost 3 to 5 times more active. Okay. So the synthetic pathway, it is the very same as we had seen during the cholesterol this glucocorticoids and this mineralocorticoid synthesis, and that is the starting element is cholesterol. Okay, and after the side chain cleavage, the formation is pregnenolone. This is the first dedicated molecule for either this adrenal corticoids or androgens. Okay, so the clear cut, the demarcation is here. So even in a zona reticularis of the adrenal cortex, this, because of the presence of the 17-20 lyase, this glucocorticoids are further pushed to the androgen pathway. Okay, the starting element is same. It is pregnenolone is the first dedicated molecule for the steroid synthesis. So when the enzyme is 3-beta dehydrogenase, 21-beta hydroxylase, and then comes 11-beta hydroxylase. That is, this is one path. And when the first path is usually mineralocorticoids, androsterone, and that is progesterone, then your last aldosterone. Okay, but here it is glucocorticoid. So extra enzyme that is required for pushing this mineralocorticoids towards glucocorticoids is 17 alpha hydroxylase. Okay, so when it is, there is deficiency of the 17 alpha hydroxylase, there is deficiency of this path, but excess of this mineralocorticoids, including progesterone. Okay, so further, when there is presence of the 17-20 lyase, probably the zona glomerulosa and zona fasciculata, they don't have this 17-20 lyase. Okay, because they don't have this 17-20 lyase, so these androgens are not synthesized in zona glomerulosa. This is zona glomerulosa, and this is zona fasciculata, and this is zona reticularis. Okay, because of this extra one enzyme, this group is formed. Because of the presence of the 17-20 lyase, the 17-hydroxyprogesterone or pregnenolone, they are pushed towards androgen pathway. And dihydroepiandrosterone and androstenedione, they are called weak androgens, weak. And their activity is usually 120 or 130. Okay. So, but ultimately, the final product is male sex hormone is testosterone. This is the prototype. Okay. But there are two paths, one through androstenedione, one through androstenedione. But the predominant path predominant path is this one, through dihydroepiandrosterone, then androsterone, and then finally testosterone. Interstitial cell cellularity, they synthesize testosterone. Okay. So we are coming to the next. Okay. So once this androstenedione is synthesized from the DHEA, in between it comes, it is DHEA, dihydroepiandrosterone. And once this is synthesized, it is converted, it is interconvertible. Okay. So it is converted to testosterone. So it is the first prototype male, is the primary compound, testosterone. It is further converted to dihydrotestosterone. It is almost 3 to 5 times more stronger than testosterone. Androgenic activity, more 3 to 5 times more androgenic activity. And the enzyme involved is 5-alpha reductase. Okay. So because of the presence of this 5-alpha reductase enzyme in certain tissues, particularly this enzyme has two isotypes. One is 5-alpha reductase type 1. And another is 2. Particularly 2 is because of 5-alpha reductase 2 that is confined to some of the things where some of the locations where your secondary sexual characters are usually seen prominent, particularly axillary hair, pubic hair, and your the face, facial hair, and the skin, where because of the presence of the dihydrotestosterone, because of the action of the 5-alpha reductase mediated dihydrotestosterone, and there is more prominent action, more prominent masculine activity or secondary sexual characters. On the other hand, when this path is blocked, suppose for any reason, or even as such, some of the testosterone get converted to estradiol, that is the female sex hormone, and the enzyme involved is aromatase. And the drugs, one is 5-alpha reductase inhibitor, that is finasteride. Another drug is in the similar drug is deutasteride. Finasteride and deutasteride, they are the 5-alpha reductase inhibitors. They are given to reduce the level of the dihydrotestosterone whenever there is excess of the androgen, particularly in benign hypertrophy of prostate and prostatic cancer. Okay, even in testicular cancers. And on the other hand, this aromatase, because testosterone is converted to female sex hormone, androstenedione is converted to estrone, and this one is estradiol. They are interconvertible. Okay. Another drug available is aromatase inhibitor, that is anastrozole. Question is, which ring of the testosterone? Testosterone has four rings, A, B, C, D, four rings. Which ring of the testosterone is aromatized? That is another question. It is the A ring. It is the A ring of the testosterone which is particularly aromatized, and that converts this male sex hormone to female sex hormone. The control, the regulation of the secretion of the testosterone, the sex hormone. Similar to your HPA axis, like hypothalamus pituitary adrenal, here also HPT axis, hypothalamus and pituitary, obviously lastly, the gonads, the testes here, okay? So hypothalamus releases the gonadotropin releasing hormone. One thing you must remember, the release is not continuous. It is pulsatile. It occurs in pulses. If it so there are pituitary gonadotropes are there. So pituitary gonadotropes respond to this pulsatile release of gonadotropin. If we give any gonadotropin artificially, or if the gonadotropin releasing hormone, so GnRH, if we give any GnRH analog, or the GnRH as such is present continuously at a continuous high level, then the pituitary will suffer, particularly pituitary gonadotropes, goserelin and buserelin. They are their artificial this synthetic GnRH analogs, and they are usually given at a high dose to prevent this pulsatile flow and suppress the release of the anterior pituitary, and subsequently FSH and LH, that is ICSH, interstitial cell. IC stands for interstitial cell stimulating hormone. So FSH LH expression will decrease because of this continuous. If it is pulsatile, then everything is okay. In the physiological thing, that is pulsatile, it stimulates the anterior pituitary positive. Then anterior pituitary releases the follicular stimulating hormone and interstitial cell stimulating hormone. Follicular stimulating hormones that acts on the seminiferous tubule, and that induces gametogenesis or spermatogenesis. Okay. And the interstitial cell in the stimulating hormone or the LH that stimulates the interstitial cells. These interstitial cells of lady, they release testosterone. Okay. So now testosterone is converted to dihydrotestosterone. Are you seeing any feedback from this dihydrotestosterone? This is another androgen. But the peculiar thing is, although it is 3 to 5 times more potent, 3 to 5 times more potent than testosterone, but it doesn't cause any feedback inhibition. No feedback inhibition. It is not involved in feedback inhibition, but instead it is involved in the androgenic activity. Okay, feedback inhibition not only because of the testosterone, but there are two additional things are also there. See here. Only thing we have just covered testosterone. Okay. Second one is estradiol. Where from the estradiol came? Because of the action of one enzyme, aromatase. Aromatase converts the testosterone to estradiol, and that also causes negative feedback inhibition similar to testosterone, both on pituitary and hypothalamus. And there was a question this time in the NEET. NEET question was that which one suppresses the pituitary and this hypothalamus to a greater extent, this one or this one or this one? Yes, estradiol inhibits the it inhibits in both male as well as female. In both male and female, the estradiol this hypothalamus pituitary axis to a greater level. Other than that, another thing is there, inhibin. Inhibin is released by the Sertoli cells. Sertoli cells. This inhibin that particularly acts on this. It is not inhibiting the hypothalamus, but it is inhibiting only pituitary. Okay. So this inhibin is inhibiting the pituitary release of only one. FSH particularly. Inhibin FSH. Further, you can see testosterone, it acts on the receptor. Receptor is androgen receptor. It can act directly. One, it can get converted to dihydrotestosterone by the 5-alpha reductase enzyme present in the target cell and then act, or it can be converted through liver, it can be converted to dihydrotestosterone and it can act. Now the metabolites. So testosterone has both active metabolites. We have seen the active metabolites. One is dihydrotestosterone because of the action of the 5-alpha reductase. Another is because of the action of the aromatase, estradiol. Two more things are there. Okay. So these are inactive metabolites. One is androsterone and it is etioconazole. Most of the metabolism occurs in where? Liver. Okay. And finally, these things, the inactive metabolites, they are excreted in urine. Okay. Next, the secretion pattern. How many peaks? 4. One is, this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, then flat, then another 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. So this one, particularly this gestational peak, mid gestation, meant for, with the purpose of this mid gestation peak is for development of the male phenotype and development of the internal sex organ. Then the second peak, why there is a second peak? Yes, it is for the descent of the testes. Then another occurs during the infancy. Mid infancy, there is another peak. Probably to settle down everything for the development, all this. So there is another third mid cycle. Mid infancy peak. Then it goes flat till the age of puberty. It is age 10. It is around 12. 12 to 13. So at that time you see the surge. Okay, the surge is so high that all the pivotal features, secondary sexual characters, start developing. Okay, it continues at a quite high level for quite some time, then it starts gradually depleting steadily throughout the life. Okay, that is the steady decline, not sudden. Okay, and towards this, actually at this point of time, actually one thing happens, that is DHP, because of the continuous presence of this dihydrotestosterone and testosterone, there is development of benign hypertrophy of prostate. Okay. And also the bone mass and overall body mass gradually declines. Bone mass, which are skeletal muscles and bone, these two, they gradually decline in mass size. Now the individual axons. Okay, so because androgen has its own receptor, so it is a what type of receptor? Nuclear receptor. So nuclear receptor means it is somewhere within the nucleus or in the cytoplasm, and after binding so it is called androgen receptor. So androgen receptor is a nuclear receptor, and after binding there is dimerization, migration into the nucleus, and binding to the specific segment of the chromosome. So androgen response element, okay, hormone response element, in general it is called HRE. According to the hormone, it becomes GRE or ARE or likewise. So anyway, so testosterone, it acts through this androgen receptor, so also the dihydrotestosterone. But the stimulation by this is around 5 times, 3 to 5 times. It is 1 times. Okay. So in the internal genitalia, it is during the mid gestation peak or during the gestation. It is causing the development, Wolffian development during the gestation. And after birth, it is causing during the puberty also. There is increased mass and strength. Okay. And these two, increase in bone mass, and it facilitates also. Here it is facilitatory, actually. It is not exactly thus erythropoiesis just because of the testosterone, because erythropoietin is the primary hormone. Erythropoietin, you know it. Okay. Poietin. So this testosterone also facilitates this erythropoietin to cause erythropoiesis. Bone mass increases, and you know, male have the higher bone mass because of this testosterone. So there are 4 things. One is internal genitalia, skeletal muscle, erythropoiesis, bone. These are because of the testosterone. Okay. And dihydrotestosterone, it is mostly responsible for those secondary sexual characters usually. One is different. One is the development is because of the testosterone, and dihydro testosterone is differentiation, not only development, but subsequently it must be differentiated into the different sex organs. Okay. And maturation during the puberty, the external genitalia, particularly it is external. And in adulthood, it leads to one disease, that is prostatic disease. And which component of the prostate is because of this dihydrotestosterone? BHP, or BPH, there are two components. One is static, another is dynamic. Dynamic is because of the contraction of the muscle. So dynamic is related to contraction, and that is taken care of by your alpha 1 inhibitors like tamsulosin. Selective alpha 1A inhibitor tamsulosin can control the static dynamic component. Okay, the isme alpha 1 antagonist, alpha 1 inhibitors. But here for this static component, you have to inhibit the dihydrotestosterone by inhibiting the 5 alpha reductase by giving, what is the drug? Finasteride. Okay, finasteride or deutasteride. Hair follicles, there is growth, that is because of the secondary sexual character. So dihydrotestosterone, development of the organs, maturation, and hair follicles. What are the locations of the this hair follicle? Where it is particularly more prominent? Usually pubic region and axillary region, and your pubic, axillary, and facial hair. And hair actually growth, it is what is the quality of the growth? Usually they become thick, and they become tortuous. Okay, thick, tortuous, and coarse, c-o-r-s, rough. Not only thick, they become rough and they become tortuous. So this is the character. And this dihydrotestosterone, both in male and female, the growth of the pubic axillary hairs and the development of the acne in the male and female both, that is sebaceous gland. So all are because of this dihydrotestosterone. And this activity is mainly because of 5 alpha reductase type 2. So estrogen obviously acts through the estrogen receptor. So there will be bone growth. The bone length is increased, but at the same time, there is epiphyseal closure. Because of the epiphyseal closure, girls, they usually grow taller initially in comparison to the same age male. But because of the quick closure of the epiphysis, there is shortening of the height. So by the age of the 16 or 17, 18, the female growth usually stops. But male continues to grow in height 2, 3, 4 years more in comparison to the female counterpart. And the second thing is libido. Libido is required both in male and female. But one thing, this libido is in case of male, in case of female, it is because of the estrogen. But in case of male, it is initiated by testosterone. But the intensity, it is initiated by testosterone, but the intensity is because of estrogen. Intensity, it will not be that much intense in case of male if the estrogen is absent. So testosterone, this is the primary compound. Okay, so there are some testosterone esters, all have testosterone in their name. Okay, so testosterone enanthate, testosterone depending upon the side group. One is enanthate, one is cypionate, and ondecanoid. These are testosterone esters. They are usually given intramuscularly, but this one, ondecanoid, this can be taken orally, I think. Testosterone ondecanoid. All the testosterone esters, they can be given intramuscularly or subcutaneously. Okay. Mainly parenterally. Okay. Not enterally. And another is transdermal patch. Okay, see, testosterone esters, they are given IM, they can be given subcutaneously also. And ondecanoid can, and one synthetic testosterone, fluximasterone, and another is methyl testosterone. Okay, they are some synthetic forms, fluximesterone particularly given orally. Okay, TD patch, the testosterone can be given as such in the form of transdermal patch, and the duration of action is usually 24 hours. You see, above the biological activity, the minimum therapeutic level maintained throughout the 24 hour period. Okay, so one patch is sufficient for delivery depending upon the requirement. Okay, the uses will uses, the next is the adverse effects and the contraindication plus your anabolic steroids will cover in the next class. For the time being, just remember, before the show ends automatically, just remember these are the all are androgens. Okay, they are androgens, synthetic testosterones, it is synthetic male sex hormones or testosterone like analog, but here anabolic activity, because they cause anabolism, the growth of muscle, they growth of bone, okay, fatty tissue, and because of this they have anabolic activity. So they have more anabolic activity than androgenic activity. They are basically androgens but have more anabolic activity, so called anabolic steroids. Okay, and one more thing, how this testosterone is circulated in the body in combination with sex hormone binding globulin. Okay, what is the life of the testosterone in the body? Very short, 15 to 20 minutes only. So someone asked in the last group, okay, why we are not giving them IV? Because why only giving transdermally? Because the dose is required is very less, we can achieve it through transdermal. Second, because of the short life, we should not give it IV because it will be metabolized, quickly metabolized by liver and excreted as your acetylcholine and androsterone. And one more thing, some of the testosterone inhibitors, because some of the enzyme inhibitors, have you heard about spironolactone, cimetidine, cytochrome P450 enzyme inhibitors? They inhibit the metabolism of the this testosterone. Normal metabolism by the liver is inhibited by cimetidine and by ketoconazole, one antifungal ketoconazole, and your one diuretic, that is spironolactone. They inhibit the cytochrome P450. So what happens? This testosterone get converted to estrogen because of the aromatase action. So now there is, because of the excess of the female sex hormone, there is gynecomastia. This is let me show that. This testosterone is not metabolized, so this path becomes active, this amount, and this leads to gynecomastia. And the drugs are, one is spironolactone, second is ketoconazole. Okay, ketoconazole, and another H2 blocker, cimetidine. Cimetidine. Okay, so uses and other things we'll see in the next class. Okay, and some other and the anti-androgens, androgen inhibitors, androgen receptor antagonist, we'll see in the next class. Okay.